Hi, I'm Jeff Yarger. I'm a professor of chemistry, biochemistry, and physics. And this video is going to look at a specific problem or exercise problem out of Atkins, edition number 2, Physical Chemistry for the Life Sciences. And more information about this problem, others in this book, as well as general topics in biophysical chemistry can be found at biopchem.education. So chapter 1 is on the first law of thermodynamics, dealing with biological systems. And a lot of this is introducing a type of energy that we often use under constant pressure conditions because of its relationship to being equal to the amount of heat in the system. In this situation, and that's the enthalpy of the system. And so a lot of when you introduce the first law in chemistry or biochemistry and thermodynamics is introducing different types of energy, specifically the enthalpy. And what I like about this specific problem, number 32, is that it gets right at the heart of some biological systems, which is the concept of protein folding, unfolding, or denaturization of the protein is often at a very fundamental level of importance to biological systems and has a lot of practical relevance in biochemistry, molecular biology, and a lot of life sciences. The problem is paraphrased here. So I've worded it a little differently than the book has, but determine the enthalpy of unfolding of lysozyme from experimental DSC data. And this is paraphrasing this question out of the book. And they give a reference where they got this data and a figure. And so what I want to do here is make a short video just kind of helping students set up this problem so that they can work it quantitatively. And I'll potentially make another video where this is worked quantitatively. But I think a lot of times it's just helping students kind of get started with this. And so to unpack this, let's first say, determine the enthalpy. So we're going to be looking for delta H, or the change in enthalpy. And what are we specifically, the change from what to what? From a folded state to an unfolded. And so that is, and it gives a figure here, and it's showing temperature versus a heat capacity. And so this, and it's even kind of showing kind of a three-dimensional molecular backbone view of lysozyme in the folded state. So this is it in its folded or native state. And then this is after it's gone unfolding, or it's unfolded here. So it's denaturized, it's unfolded, it's gone from this helical structure to a random coil structure. So this is often called a helix to coil transition as well. So there's a lot of different nomenclature and names given to this first part of the problem. Lysozyme is a very common enzyme protein that initially gets studied because it's very easy to work with experimentally. It doesn't denature very easily, etc. And experimentally, DSC is a very common type of calorimetry. It stands for differential scanning calorimetry, and I have separate videos on calorimetry to go through some of this in detail. And then the problem also gives where they, in a sense, made this, they got this data from, how they've made this figure 1.7 or 1.27 is from data from Privoloff, Analytical Biochemistry, Volume 79, page 232, which was published in 1995. And so what I like to say is, let's start there. And this is often one of the steps that students I strongly encourage, which is to look up multiple points of reference when looking at this type of material. So the textbook does give a brief introduction to calorimetry, DSC, and protein folding, unfolding, but in no means is this textbook or any other one that is covering a large range of thermodynamic biochemistry topics exhaustive on this topic. So let's start by looking up the paper they reference, but then there's also, you know, numerous textbooks that go into the calorimetry of proteins and unfolding in a lot more detail. So really, I like to start by looking up a few other things. So when we look up this paper, and if you're at a university, you usually have access to be able to, through the library system, to download digital copies of this, which is what I did. I went to the journal, found this, and downloaded a PDF, and I'm showing a part of it here. In fact, I'm showing the first part of that, which gives the title of the paper, the authors, the citation right here. And then I show figure number 6, which is showing in kilojoules per mole Kelvin. So it's showing, in a sense, a heat capacity as a function of temperature. So in a sense, it is where this diagram, you know, was developed from. And they've added in, so this is the experimental, data right here. And then they've added in some additional lines here, which are indicating, I'm going to put it in a different color. So this is indicating, if you were to extrapolate the unfolded state, and this one right here is extrapolating the folded heat capacity. And the one in between is kind of showing you as it's delta CP as you go from the folded to the unfolded state here. So in a sense, what we're looking for is the area under this baseline as you go from the folded to the unfolded state, we're looking for the integrated area of that. And they give you values that they determine using this method. And I blanked them out here so that we could look at this in more detail. And then they also, later on, figure 7, they show, again, the heat capacity now in not in kilojoules per mole Kelvin, but in kilocalories. And again, your book states in the problem that they converted the kilocalories to kilojoules to keep it consistent. But we can generally see that we're seeing a transition that, around 65 degrees Celsius, it happens over a, delta T of around, 15 degrees Celsius or 15 degrees Kelvin, right? And that's what you would say here too. They don't give you as many ticks here, but this is at about 65, and it's told in the figure caption here. So that goes along with what you see here, where you see this, you see that, you could imagine this, and we're trying to determine the delta H will be that integrated heat capacity, right? Because again, so why is this experimental DSC data able to get this? Well, this is done at constant pressure. So what is the constant pressure molar heat capacity is dH dT at constant P and N, number of moles. So we're not changing the thing. So dH will be CP dT. And if we integrate over this, and we assume that the heat capacity is somewhat constant, which as you can see it, then we're going to get that this will be the heat capacity delta T, right? And so that's kind of what we're using here. And what we're doing is integrating over this heat capacity over the temperature at which the transition happens, right? So, you know, that's what this paper does. Now, if you look this up, if you do like a Web of Science search or any type of Google Scholar search or any type of academic journal, you're going to find that there's lots of papers, you know, on this topic, on the unfolding of lysozyme. And so I give another one here in the Journal of Physical Chemistry, B, in 2010, volume 114, in page 16,881 is where it starts. And this is figure four showing, again, a DSC trace where it's heat capacity in kilojoules per mole K. And again, you can see that this matches up with, you know, the figure given in the book. This is at about, you know, you can see 65 degrees here. It's happening over a temperature range of, you know, 15 to 20 degrees Celsius, right? It even gives kind of this delta CP here of, you know, 6 kilojoules per mole K, right? So you could look up several references and get different data, which you could then analyze to give you slightly different results, but you're gonna always get in kind of the same ballpark. And so let's just start by, where is that ballpark? So like I said, what we're really kind of doing here is asking, what is the area that I've highlighted right here? And so let me just give you kind of, you can imagine different levels of sophistication here of being able to do this. What do you make this baseline? In other words, you don't want to integrate all the way down to zero here. This is not the area you want. You want to do it from this baseline here and just integrate over the data as I've highlighted this area right here. And so, you know, one, you know, quick estimate of that is just to say that this happens over, you know, about a, say, you know, a 20 degree, you know, if we did it from 50 to 70 here, and we went and it starts at around 20, you know, what is this, you know, box right here? And that's going to overestimate, you know, that by about a factor of two. But that's a, you know, a delta T of about 20 degrees here. And from 20, you know, up to, we'll call it, you know, right around, you know, 90. So, you know, that's 70, right? So this will be 20 degrees Kelvin and 70 kilojoule K mole here. So you'll get about 1400 kilojoules per mole, right? And like we said, like that is, you know, that would be this entire box here. And you can see that easily overestimates it by a factor of two. So that means, like, I would kind of guess this to be, you know, probably less than a factor of two. So less than 700 kilojoules per mole is where I'm going to, you know, estimate this without working it at all. Now, what do we need to actually work this? Well, the first step is to tabulate some numerical data based on this plot. So to extrapolate what these data points are, and then to do some type of numerical integration where you split it up into boxes. And so the simplest numerical integration, you know, just takes squares over different temperature ranges, right? And that is a numerical integration approximation of that. And the finer you split this up, and if you switch it from squares to trapezoids, it approximates it any even better, et cetera, is going to get you closer to that. Also, where you don't, where this baseline isn't fixed, but it's, you know, a sloped line, or it matches this delta CP, will get you even closer. So you can see, as you do higher levels of kind of numerical integrations of this data, better approximations of the baseline, you're going to get closer and closer, you know, to the value of the change in enthalpy for this transition. And so this is what this problem is having you do: work with real world data, do real-world estimations and numerical integrations to look at an important problem, which is, you know, what are the thermodynamics? What's the change in energy when you go from a folded to an unfolded state in a protein? And it's looking at a specific one. So hopefully this helps set up the problem for you so that you can work this numerically yourself, starting by and look at kind of all the concepts, both the calorimetry concepts, looking at working with some of that calorimetry data to give you some of these enthalpy or energies of certain types of transitions, and have that even then, once you've started doing that, start approaching what is causing those energy changes from kind of a biochemistry or molecular standpoint. Thanks.